take sunglasses off.
You want to sit up there, Mary?
Thank you.
that was totally unrelated. That was like coincidence. It'll be interesting.
Pick and choose.
Okay.
I'm a basic.
The bucket right there.
Okay, thank you.
I know. Yeah. I'm very distraught.
Saints.
Distinguished guests, friends, family, students, alumni, members of the Board of Governors, and most importantly, members of the class of 2022. On behalf of the faculty, staff, and administration of the school, it is my distinct privilege to welcome you to Indian Springs' 68th commencement. I had hoped that this graduation would be free of any mention of the words COVID or pandemic. Unfortunately, that is not the case, and we have had some members of the community test positive recently. This was not our plan, nor does it seem fair. It is, however, a reminder that things in life don't always go according to plan. They actually rarely do, nor is life always fair. It is also a reminder that we must remain flexible, we must persevere, and we must roll with the punches. I'm grateful to the Springs community for doing so today. While I am disappointed that not everyone in our community is able to be here, it will not stop us from recognizing the individual and collective accomplishments of the class of 2022. To those that are not here in person, know that your presence is felt. On this day, we celebrate the culmination of a journey that was 1 to 5 years in the making, a journey made possible by all those in attendance and so many others that are not with us today. Although our main focus on this beautiful day are the 70 unique and amazing members of the class of 2022, I want to acknowledge and thank on their behalf the many people in their lives that helped make this celebration possible. Few, if any, accomplishments are individual successes. They are instead shared by those who have given so generously of themselves to make these individual accomplishments possible. Accomplishments made even greater by loved ones who challenged us to think better, think bigger, and think more boldly than we ever thought might have been possible. To the parents, grandparents, aunts, uncles, siblings, friends, teachers, coaches, mentors, and so many others, thank you for investing yourselves into these amazing young people. To the members of the class of 2022, this journey has not always been easy for you nor the people that love you most. When you have struggled, so have they. When you cried tears of joy or pain, we all did. When you have beamed with pride, so many others have as well. Your parents in particular have made tremendous sacrifices, personal and financial, to provide you with this journey. They are here today to celebrate you. I hope the magnitude of this moment will stay with you for a lifetime. I'd ask that each of you look into the faces of your loved ones and take a mental snapshot. They are so proud of the young person you have become. None of us is perfect, but all of us are incredibly fortunate to be loved by so many. Seniors, I would ask that you please rise right now and join me in thanking your parents and friends and family for all the support that they have given you throughout your spring's journey and your lives. Several months ago, I gave the senior class a homework assignment. You might see some worried faces right now, because it's a good thing that assignment wasn't graded and did not count towards your graduation requirements, because a fair number of you would not be in attendance today. For those that did indulge me, you may recall that I asked you to share with me what you want your legacy to be after you leave Springs. Whether or not you shared with me that headline of your legacy, I hope you'll remember the story of Alfred Nobel, the Nobel of the Nobel Prizes. After a newspaper mistakenly published Alfred's obituary upon his brother's death, Alfred had the unique opportunity to see how he would be remembered. As the inventor of dynamite, Alfred discovered his legacy was not as flattering as he may have hoped. He spent the remainder of his life changing that narrative and evolving his legacy. How do you want this community to remember you? This is a simple yet profound question. And dare I say, the timing of my question was a brilliant attempt to keep you motivated during the second half of your senior year. Whether it worked or not is debatable, but I was impressed by the thoughtfulness of the responses I received. I want to circle back to some of those messages that you shared with me and perhaps reinforce some guidance and advice as you continue to craft your legacies moving forward. These may be applicable to many, if not all of you. One member of the senior class I shared, there are intangible qualities that all the greatest possess. Lead by example. Motivate others to do their best. Oftentimes, the difference between good and great comes down to one's character. to another on the notion of genuinely caring about those around us. I shared, "It is also what I believe the world needs more of, particularly with the polarization we are witnessing across the country and the globe. Go forward and be a beacon of hope and goodness for the rest of us to see and emulate. Care deeply and let others know you care through your actions. If you do so, you will live a successful life, but also a meaningful one. I wish nothing less than this for you to lead a meaningful and life of purpose." On one student's remarks on leaving his mark, I shared, "As you think about leaving your mark, I hope you will befriend some of our youngest students at Springs and be a strong mentor to them. Do this in life with those that you're fortunate to work with or associate with. If you do, you have the opportunity to develop an endearing legacy, one that those individuals will help carry forward. Springs needs this, your peers need this, and certainly the world needs this." To yet another on the topic of leading others, I shared, "Like all the greats in history, your team, your family, your company, your country will count on you to set the tone. Such is the burden of leadership. Embrace this now and in the future. Life is a team sport, and you cannot cement your legacy without the help of others. Hold yourself and others accountable for the small details. These are often the corners we cut because no one else is watching. Cutting corners in life will not allow you to achieve greatness." To another young person, I shared the following. "I also see your natural ability to fluidly move between different groups and be equally respected across all groups. You have the ability to bring people together with your relatability. Thank you for setting that tone. Continue to do so in college and throughout life. Not only will you be made better by these efforts, but the community you inhabit will be that much stronger for them." Finally, to one last young person in the senior class, I shared the following. "Challenge your own assumptions and be open to the perspectives of others. If you do, you very well may see the world differently, in 3D or even 4D. We are often made to believe that everything in life is a binary. If one thing is right, everything else must be wrong. This, however, doesn't take into account the complexity and intricacies of the world, nor does it take into account the human spirit. We can and change through life experiences. Experience life to the fullest by learning from everyone you meet." If my attempts, seniors, to confer some last-minute words of wisdom have fallen flat, I will spare you additional attempts today. Instead, I will leave you with a gift. As you walk across the stage to receive your diploma, Mr. Wolf will hand each of you a package. Inside is a gift that I hope you'll take with you throughout life, and in your most trying moments, open and read. It is a book. I am, in fact, an educator, and I love books. It's David Foster Wallace's This Is Water, Some Thoughts Delivered on a Significant Occasion About Living a Life of Living a Compassionate Life. Based on his commencement address in 2005, David Foster Wallace challenged the graduates of Kenyon College to think compassionately. There's a number of mathematicians sitting to my left. For those mathematicians, that's right, that's two commencement addresses delivered to you in one ceremony. How fortunate are you? You may read the messages inside the book at different inflection points in your life. When you turn to these pages, I hope you'll look fondly at the book plate on the inside front cover. Each of your books is inscribed with a message from one of your teachers that has cared deeply for you along your Springs journey. Although each of you are still crafting your individual legacies, that of the class is clearly defined in my mind. The class of 2022 is composed of amazing and passionate young people with some of the most brilliant minds I will ever know, despite sometimes a lack of common sense. I've learned that every spring's class describes themselves as the great class of whatever year. I am confident that this year's graduating class is, in fact, bound for greatness, the great class of 2022. I say this in part because most of what you do, you tackle with a certain level of joy that further nurtures your creativity and inspires you and each other to push further and think more boldly. We talked about this yesterday. Even when a group of you had the opportunity to continue learning through living in what I have recently coined character development days during the last week of your high school career in the aftermath of your senior prank, you have done so joyfully and passionately and with a smile on your faces. We will miss this next year on a daily basis. The Indian Springs class of 2022 will forever be bound together by the uncommon experience of their spring's journey. As you prepare to leave the relative comfort of the Springs campus, know that you are prepared to do so, that you are worthy of the challenges ahead, that you are more than good enough, and most importantly, know that you are loved. I'd like to invite Emma Pang to the stage to deliver some opening remarks in on behalf of her classmate, Frankie Shen.
I speak on behalf of a dear friend and fellow classmate, Frankie Shen, who unfortunately could not be here today in person with us. Here's his speech as he is prepared. I want to start my speech with a rather trivial story of me traveling to the United States for the first time, coping with something as abysmal and inexplicable as the Customs and Border Protection Agency. It started when my plane landed in Chicago O'Hare, and I was rushing to catch a connecting plane to Birmingham, picturing my life at the still remaining hearsay of Indian Springs School. The customs officer, a young African-American woman, suddenly changed her usual procedural manner, picked up my I-20 form with a look of either curious or suspicious. At least my younger self could not tell. After several embarrassing seconds of silence, she asked me, "Why are you going to Alabama?" Subsequently, she gave me an enigmatic smile. I got nervous. The phrase, secondary inspection, aka the little dark room, started echoing in my mind. I was in a total brain blackout. For some reason that I still cannot explain, I spilled out, "Beautiful landscape." Then she laughed and let me pass. With a little tumult, I eventually made it to the campus of our school, and everything seemed incredibly different from my conventional understanding of high school. To put aside those dry rankings, such as the best school in the South, which, by the way, is true, and the most beautiful campus in the US, which is also true, I saw an unbelievably dynamic place with glass classrooms, integrating students into the beauty of nature, a summer camp-like surrounding, encouraging us to canoe or hike in our free time, the idyllic teacher-student relationship with faculty who we sincerely enjoy talking to, and maybe later become lifelong friends with. As a graduating student, I look back. My life in Indian Springs is marked by mistakenly running into Mrs. Jacobs' world history class on the first day of school, and sitting in the first row in panic, figuring out how to convince the dean of academics that I actually skipped one class to attend another. Ooh. Traveling with Mr. Belser and the robotics team to Enterprise, eating my first Chick-fil-A sandwich, binge-watching 5 episodes of Mr. Muhammad teaching physics Saturday night on the other side of the Pacific Ocean, going to a place called Waffle House, which our dear former mayor, Andy Schwebel, believes must be subsidized by state tax and written into Constitution as a basic right of Alabamians. Eventually, after publicly, memorably quitting in the first week of ninth grade, rejoining choir and giving me the chance to tell Mr. Dibble about the senior reconciliation with my younger self. Through my life as a boarder, after overcoming probably the worst morning traffic in Birmingham, which is from our dorms to the classroom, life became surprisingly cheerful and tranquil. I chat with my friends and eat marshmallows at the bonfire and climb to the top of shipping containers to enjoy the scenery of the back forests. My experience goes beyond the limits of the campus. With company of friends and shared curiosities, I've spent my weekends and breaks touring the state of Alabama, meandering along the interstates and highways to observe the rather absurd and inexplicable countrysides, driving through the vibrant college towns, seeing the faces of students all around the globe, strolling down downtown Birmingham to commemorate the civil rights movement and witness the rise and fall of the iron industry, epitomized by the change over time of the World Woodward Building. To think of all this, what matters the most in the end, in these last few hours of being a spring student, is to reflect and celebrate things that I've learned and quests I've taken up, education-wise or judiciary-wise, to look ahead in my life. I anxiously imagine everything being so different as the past 4 years have been so bizarre that I cannot believe they actually happened. So I started to memorize the past to comfort my nostalgic mind. Inspired by the exotic darkness and lack of modern technology when Alabama Power gave up its motto and occasionally decided to power off, I began to consider the most primitive but enduring way of recording and conveying my experience is to tell a story. It could be the story of my high school, the story of the class of 2022, or it could be as simple as a story of myself. As Mr. Wolf says, there is not a school like Indian Springs in the state of Alabama, and there are very few in the U.S. Think about the creation story of Indian Springs, this MIT graduate, multimillionaire, industrialist heir, Harvey G. Woodward, and his wish of creating a school with no religious affiliation, no fixed school curriculum, and a strict student self-government in 1930s rural Alabama, and to think of Doc Armstrong's provision on holistic education, which brought him from the Peabody School to this once middle of nowhere, building this unprecedented school. It all sounds so radical, and even fanatical to me, that I always want to dig out more tales and memories from the past to find the timeless wisdom from our elders. Once I found this photo of the architects inspecting the chosen site of the future Indian Springs School, indecipherably staring at the unseen fronts, leaving fences, cows, and bushes behind, looking utterly confused, I suddenly realized that maybe some stories can only truly be understood by their participants, and that those springs emiriti, adored by the library portraits, could once be as confused as us. Therefore, I started to recollect those definitive and springs-only moments of our class. We had a tumultuous administration change in the beginning and throughout our years of moving upward in town hall seating. We had our uneasy farewells to beloved teachers like Mrs. Cole, Mrs. Gray, Dr. Horn, Mr. Pollard, and then eventually COVID struck, changing life for all of us. In retrospect, the class of 2022 story is bizarre, adventurous, sometimes painful, leading to confusion, but I believe we have the legacy of overcoming those difficulties, choosing a rather advantageous way of living, and appreciating the strangeness and alienness of our time. Just like in every good story, I like to have the ending echo its beginning. I've taken you guys on a detour, so now let's loop back to the first day of our ninth grade. It is a new student orientation, and we've been asked this question. Do you leave more in the people changing the environment, or the environment changing the people? The younger me chose to loiter in my mind, therefore missing the entire question. But today I'd like to take time to answer it. I think to a certain extent, both are true. But I want to overturn the foundation of this question. I want to challenge the assumption that everything is static and passively waiting to be changed, and that everything has a moment of final interpretation. Some believe our high school will end at the moment we receive our diplomas, but I think it might never end. There's no such thing as closure, and our high school stories will grow on our own experience after entering adult life. And every time we look back, the plots and meanings will be altered a bit. And once in a while, when we come back and revisit our stories, we will see the amazing changes of both ourselves and this place. Now here's my epilogue. From the last stanza of our senior choir song titled North, smaller than dust on this map, lies the greatest thing we have, the dirt in which our roots may grow and the right to call it home. Thank you.
like to invite our fall mayor, Andy Schwebel, to the podium.
I'll let the choir kids get back a little bit. You know, it's funny, isn't it? Last year there was one graduation speaker who couldn't speak. This year there's only one who can. Okay, I'll just start. So first of all, I want to say to my classmates, I want to say congratulations. I remember the first time I went to a graduation here. I was in ninth grade, and I was like, oh, congratulations. And I was like, man, it's not a really big deal. You can get straight C's and still get the piece of paper, you know? But as many of you know, I was sort of immature in ninth grade. And I've learned that making it here actually involves a great sacrifice on our part and our parents' part and lots of people's part. And not everyone makes it. That's not to say, though, that those who were part of our class but didn't graduate today weren't integral parts of our class. And as we're celebrating our accomplishments, we're also celebrating all the connections we made along the way. That includes everyone who's been part of our grade. On that note, here's a little story. After I watched Xanadu this semester, I went to Waffle House with a group of people. And one of those people was Miller Simon, who you may remember was in our grade for some time and then left. And I didn't really talk to Miller too much when Miller was at Springs, but at Waffle House this night, Miller was like, Andy, I have one really distinct memory of you from ninth grade. I was like, oh no. Miller was like, yeah, it was in Miss Jacobs' class. I was like, oh, no. And then Miller said, basically what happened was Miss Jacobs going around asking everyone how their day's going, and Miller said, Miss Jacobs, terrible, it's doing terrible, everything's going badly. And apparently, I turned around and really loud for the whole class to hear. I was like, Miller, that's not what you're supposed to say. I was sort of right, you know, because you're supposed to say, oh, fine, thank you, and yourself, right? But what Springs has taught me is that maybe being honest about how you're feeling is what you should do, what you should say, right? Because even if it's easy to say, oh, fine, thank you, when you're opening yourself up and losing your fear and admitting how you actually feel, you're allowing yourself to have more meaningful interpersonal connections and also letting yourself be helped. I don't think there's many schools in the whole world that are like Springs that teach you to think outside the box and to rethink social norms if you think there's something that can be gained from it. So then I think it's very much in the spirit of this school, as we celebrate our graduation, to really think critically about what our time here meant for us. I am more than anything, it was a time for experimentation. Intellectually and socially, we knew we could take risks, knowing we had a supporting community and caring adults to fall back on if we needed. You know, here's an example. Even if you make a horrendous mistake, with a few exceptions, you can get kicked out of the school. But mostly, the worst thing that can happen to you is you get a bunch of work hours, which several seniors know something about. But work hours are not primarily punitive. Instead, the point of the work hour is that they're designed to create forgiveness, right? The students on judiciary and the teachers and the adults you do your work hours with are creating a system in which you can give back to your community. And once the giving back is done, right, everything's back to normal. I have a great story about that too. Once, this year, this semester actually, I was going to the food truck, the Sage food truck with Reese. And we get to the food truck, and inside is Aiden Clark, and he's serving hot dogs because he has work hours. And Reese doesn't even think. Reese looks up and down, and he says, like, ooh, I thought the lunch ladies were hot. I thought that was hilarious. That was so funny. But anyways, point being, work hours are not a huge deal. You give back to your community, and then things are back to normal. The truth is, though, this is the last time we're all going to be together in one place. And you know where we're going next, the real world, so to speak, is a little less forgiving, I think. You don't get work hours in the real world. You have to find a way to make amends yourself. But the truth is, since we've had practice here at Springs, we're really more prepared than 99.5% of our peers to go out into this world. And that's really an unfair state of affairs, which gives us a lot of power and privilege, and we now have to decide how we're going to use that. The easiest thing for us to do, of course, is you grow up, have kids, if you want, send them to Springs, and the system works great for you, but nothing in the world really changes. However, I think we can do better than that. As Springs, we learned that we have to take care of each other because we're in a community. And if our community is larger and includes the whole world, we can do that too. So anyways, I'll conclude with everybody's favorite subject, Springs history. In 1930, Harvey Woodward died. He had his own demons, maybe, but he died. And he left his money for a school because, you know, he was educated in the North, MIT, and he thought boys in Alabama simply did not have the same opportunity as boys in the rest of the world, and he wanted to fix that state of affairs, right? And I'm not sure he'd be super delighted about this, like, graduating class. You know, we've got people of color, Jews, Catholics, women. he didn't like any of those groups. However, he would be delighted and satisfied by the fact that we're walking across this stage today and we're getting our diploma and we're going to have as much opportunity moving forward in our lives as anyone else anywhere in the world, anywhere in the United States. So really, his school is a success. And I think it's on us now, as alumni of Indian Springs School, as we move into our own futures, to channel the spirit of Mr. Woodward. Not the racist spirit, the opportunity to channel the spirit of Mr. Woodward and extend the opportunity we've been giving here at Indian Springs to all of our equally deserving peers around the United States, around the world. And I think if we do that, we'll take the lessons we learned here and we'll carry them with us for the rest of our lives and beyond. So thank you all so much. Thank you.
I would now like to invite Bruce Lanier to the podium to speak on behalf of his classmate and Spring Mayor, Joseph Katz.
So I would first like to start this speech off by thanking Joseph. I know I, as long as probably everybody else here, would much rather have Joseph here to give his speech. Because what Joseph has done for this community as a student, a friend, and a mayor is just, you can't compare it to much else. So as I give this speech, just imagine a slightly taller, curly hair, contagious smile that we all know that Joseph has. This semester, as we filed into the massive halls of Wandale High School during choir tour, Nate Street made some comment about how much he loved watching Springs kids pretend to be normal. At first, I laughed because he was spot on with his analysis of what was going on. Just before his remarks, I concealed a toy pig that I had carried around for most of the trip in my jacket, and a few of my friends were singing sea shanties. Soon after, however, a thought occurred to me that made me momentarily panic. Is this what the next chapter of my life would feel like? A constant struggle to be on good behavior as I exit this bubble into the real world. And I am absolutely certain that I am not alone in my concern about the habits I've developed at Springs. Just as I will need to start keeping track of my water bottle and backpack, Henry Spradlin won't be able to sing Mendelssohn very louder in classes anymore. Adrian, currently used to napping on every outdoor surface imaginable at Indian Springs, will likely find that the streets of Chicago are not quite so welcome to the chronically sleepy. Though Dr. Gray was tolerant of his shenanigans, Reese may encounter some troubles if he tries tricking his future math professors with Joe Mama jokes. Italy is a big and diverse country, but I strongly doubt that Chris will be able to find someone willing to listen to him talk about tendon stretches for more than 5 minutes. Frankie's future roommate probably won't appreciate him cooking secret steaks in the middle of the night. Aiden will have to be on time for morning drills. Bates will have to stop pretending to bite people. And Herschel, please listen closely. If you take away nothing else from these last 5 years, remember there is always, always enough time to put on socks. I bring up these examples not to criticize us or just to be like, oh, look how quirky Springs is. But rather, because all of these seemingly insignificant peculiarities, even the gross sock thing, provide evidence of the deep felt sense of comfort and belonging felt by many at Springs. Yes, learning through living has a lot to do with making mistakes in a forgiving environment, but it is also about discovering new aspects of ourselves in an inclusive setting, or as Andy put it, rethinking social norms when there's something to be gained from it. Even when all one stands to gain is a new perspective, a fond memory, or a good laugh. So to convince you that all of the foolishness of the last 4 years has enriched at least one life, I'd like to share one of my Spring's favorite memories. Picture this. It's senior night for the soccer team. No, not varsity senior night. Junior varsity senior night. A tradition that I don't think exists outside of Springs. On this occasion, I, the former equipment manager, have finally been allowed to play up top as striker. A beautiful shot attempt by Reese bounces off the goalpost to my feet, and I sink it into the top corner. The large crowd of Indian Springs fans go wild as I celebrate with my fellow teammates. It sounds almost cinematic, and it felt that way at the time. But there's one detail I left out. Our opponents were not hulking athletes, but rather a petite bunch of students, none older than 16. I even recognized some of our competitors as close friends of my seventh grade little brother. Objectively, we looked a bit ridiculous as we showed up to school in Hawaiian shirts and sent out essays and poetry about our exploits in school-wide emails. And yet, the swamp supported us at every step of the way. Where else could an unathletic individual named Slow Joe in middle school be cheered on as he struggled to stop accidentally fouling other players or learn how to play goalie without any prior experience? I really cannot imagine finding another community that offers that kind of unconditional love and support. So yes, maybe it's time for us to come down to earth a little bit, but let's not be hasty. While we develop the skills we need to get by as college students and adults, we can still unabashedly embrace our quirks and try our best to bring a little bit of the magic we felt here to everyone else. We may risk making fools of ourselves occasionally, but I'm confident that the world will be better off for it. Thank you.
The Leadership Award is given in memory of Charles Jordan McDavid, Jr., class of 1958. The recipient is selected by the faculty on the basis of exemplary leadership and character exhibited through the participation in student activities. It is my honor to present this year's Leadership Award to Andrew Schwabel. Before we recognize this year's recipients of the Spiritual Awareness Award, I want to take a moment and acknowledge a great loss for the Springs community. The Spiritual Awareness Awards have historically been presented by Mac Fleming, whom we lost this school year after serving the institution for a remarkable 70 years. Mr. Fleming touched the lives of generations of Springs students and loves celebrating their successes at graduation each year. Although Mac Fleming is no longer with us, there's little doubt that his presence is felt by all in attendance today who were blessed to have known him. the responsibility of presenting the Spiritual Awareness Award will, fittingly, now and into the future, rest with the senior-most member of the faculty. I invite Dr. Mac Lacoste, math faculty and distinguished scholar, to the stage to present this year's awards.
Spiritual Awareness Awards are given in memory of Alan Lee Voy Furness, class of 1963, and Robert Barry Cardis, class of 1968. The recipients are recognized by their peers in the senior class as embodying the qualities of dignity, humanitarianism, and spiritual awareness. It is my distinct honor to recognize this year's recipients of the Spiritual Awareness Award, Ola Elobidi and Andrew Schwab.
The Libby Pantazis Award recipient is selected by the faculty on the basis of exemplary dedication, joy, passion, and service to the school. It is my distinct pleasure to present the Libby Pantazis Award to Lucy Gardner. I would now like to invite Elizabeth Goodrich, Chair of the Board of Governors for the 2022-2023 school year, to the podium.
The McDonald B. Fleming Distinguished Service Award is given in memory of Mac Fleming. From the school's founding and for a remarkable 70 years, Mac Fleming was a stalwart on the faculty. Throughout his tenure, Mac exemplified the school's mission and values. This year, in recognition of his lifetime of service to Indian Springs School, the Board of Governors has named the Distinguished Service Awards in honor of Mac. Selected by the Board of Governors, this year, the McDonald B. Fleming Distinguished Service Award will be presented to three members of the Indian Springs community. I would first ask Cindy Van Horn to please join me on the stage. For 33 years, Cindy Van Horn has served the Indian Springs community dutifully and with great joy as a library assistant and later as the school's librarian. Cindy first moved to campus with her husband, Greg, in 1980, and was an active member of the residential life community until 2020. Cindy's contributions and service to the Springs community are too plentiful to fully detail, but her impact will continue to be felt for years to come. Cindy will be retiring from Indian Springs School at the conclusion of this school year, and with gratitude, the Board of Governors commends Cindy Van Horn for her years of distinguished service to Indian Springs School and to the students who have thrived as the result of her efforts. Please join me in recognizing Cindy Van Horn and congratulating her on her retirement. I hope Dr. Lacoste didn't get far. Dr. Lacoste, will you join me on the stage? Dr. Mac Lacoste joined the Indian Springs faculty in 1972 and is celebrating his 50th year teaching at the school. Dr. Lacoste has served as both a physics teacher and a math teacher. He is universally recognized by Springs students past and present as one of the smartest people they have ever known. Countless alums credit Dr. Lacoste for launching their careers in physics and math. Dr. Lacoste's service to Springs has included being part of the residential life community, co-coaching the academic decathlon team and the Scholars Bowl team, and participating in the trivia team that beat Altamont twice. The Board of Governors thanks and commends Dr. Lacoste for reaching the remarkable milestone of 50 years of distinguished service to the school and for tirelessly giving his time and talent to the students who have thrived as a result of his efforts. Please join me in recognizing Dr. Lacoste. Recipient of the McDonald B. Fleming Distinguished Service Award is Alan Engel, class of 1973. Alan, will you please join me? Alan Engel has been an important part of the Indian Springs community since his days as a student, as an alumnus, and since he and his wife Lisa sent their children, Andrea Haynes, 03, and Alana Engel, 12, to the school. Alan's involvement in the school includes serving on the Alumni Council and on the Board of Governors starting in 2006. Alan has graciously given of his time and talents as a member of the Executive Committee, Chair of the Finance Committee, and Chair of the Board from 2018 until 2022. His work helping lead strategic planning, capital improvement initiatives, and the campus master plan has transformed the Springs campus and positioned the school for continued success. Alan is a true servant leader, and the school has benefited from his steadfast commitment and unwavering support, most notably navigating the school through leadership transitions, a pandemic, a tornado, and a significant flood. The Board of Governors is grateful to Alan for giving his time, talent, and resources to Indian Springs School while serving with distinction. Please join me in thanking Alan Engel for his distinguished service to Indian Springs and to the students who have thrived.
I now ask that Dr. John Gray, our academic dean, come to the podium to present this year's graduates, and that Alan Engel, board chair for the 2021-2020 school year, help confer the diplomas. A word of note, graduates will not be called in alphabetical order this year, given the need for spacing and the uniqueness of this ceremony. Instead, diplomas will be selected at random to keep everyone on their toes. Something that this class has always done. To add a little joy to this joyful class and this celebration, the first name called, the 22nd name called in honor of the class of 22, and the last name called will receive some additional spring swag from the advancement office.
Joey Zhu. Nicholas Zayden Johnson. Simon Zhaoyi Ma. Thomas James French. Sava Pepmeyer. Abby Ritchie. Andrew Chang Schwabel. Jing Zhuyi Jerry in absentia. Catherine Ann Fitzgibbon. Marina Luca Anna Schmidt. Yong Xingya Angela. Gang Shu Chao Cindy. Hu Yilan. William Rains Faulkner. Haosheng Hudson Wong, in absentia. Grace Jordan Flowers. Elizabeth Abraisley Zanatti. Jacob Justice Blessa. Christian Suede Suede. Lucy Elizabeth Gardner. Reese Thomas Yone. We have reached number 22. Hayden Olivia Shell. Amethyst Morricani, in absentia. Ola Muhammad Ali Elobidi. Sherry Lynn Drew Peng. Bruce Nicholas Lanier IV. Emma Peng. Rian Barrington Wilby, in absentia. Aiden James Clark. Ivan Zhu. Jordan Alexander De Los Santos. Sila Rose Komisar. Christopher Lee Bradley. Olivia Danielle Clifton. Aaliyah Faye Ward. Shin, Junkai, Jason. William Carter Dunaway. Ife Crystal Lee, in absentia. Hao Wellington Zhang. Rosie Ivy Otter. Kennedy Olivia Tyson. Nathan Taylor Tozzi. Anna Caroline Bates. Joseph Blanco Katz. In absentia. Zola Bell Thompson. Sadicha Sharesta. Linda Soon. Caroline Lee Beecher. Anna Elizabeth McDaniel McCormick. Henry Davenport Spradlin. Harshal Yogesh Mehta. Frankie Yiheng Shen. In absentia. Constantine Hartman. Michael Anthony Antune. Adrian Elizabeth Belzer. Lo Yishang, in absentia. Jefferson Sims Tosh. Justin Tyler Nelson. Sid Reddy Jetty, in absentia. Catherine Kung. Emiliano Rafael Martinez. Jackson Steele Neighbors. Sophia Genevieve Montleone. Seth Walton. Zheng Ruyi. Olivia Naomi Honeycutt, in absentia. Virginia Pendleton Slaughter. Addison Lee Miller. Elijah Roja Bai. And our final graduate, Andrew Glassford.
Let me now present to you the class of 2022. I would now like to invite Caroline Bates to the podium to deliver our closing remarks on behalf of her classmate, Hudson Wang.
Thank you, Mr. Schamberger, for the step stool. So as Mr. Schamberger, or I like to call him Shammy or Sham Sham, just said, I am not Hudson, but I will be delivering his speech today. He was chosen by the senior class to deliver a speech at graduation, and honestly, that came as no surprise to me because he is such a wonderful friend and an integral part of the Springs community. So, Hudson, we miss you, and I hope that I do your words justice. 2 months ago, when I was drafting for this very speech, I wrote about my transformational journey at Springs and how I evolved from a reserved kid to an open-minded and outgoing person. I thought my Springs experiences in theater, student government, and varsity soccer are something extraordinary to be mentioned. And I thought that it was unique in the way those experiences taught me to unbind myself from the expectations and push for the uncomfortable. But the truth is that everyone here has a special Springs experience that is worth noting. And like them, I definitely would not have been able to feel my accomplishments without learning from each other, our teachers, and the staff in the last 4 years. Indeed, when I decided to audition for Rocky Horror Picture Show, my sophomore year musical, as someone who had never participated in a musical before, I would not have guessed that I would end up on stage 6 weeks later as Rocky Horror, a sex machine in a crop top and a blonde wig. But the memories that will last forever for me would be nowhere without the excitement in Nancy's "Do It With Me" nights before the audition, Mr. Peterson's relentless showcasing of the campy and over-the-top energy by yelling, "More, more," in rehearsals. Singers at the time, such as Phoebe, CJ, and Kate's contagious laughs when they explored in their characters, and the opening night's full house, the audience's giggles, and their applauses at even the most unexpected moments. Indeed, when Simon and I decided to sing an original rap song as our student government election speech in our sophomore year, we wouldn't have known that we could defeat two seniors of unrivaled popularity. But we could only convert our efforts into an American dream type story with Mr. Ellenis's offer of a gigantic speaker on the day of our speech. The commissioners of citizenship promised to keep it our secret, and our good friend and now alumni, James Zhang, who stayed up with us creating beats and rhymes in perhaps Isaac Chow's previously crazy hip hop performance in the student concert that inspired us to the key to the popularity may be outside of the box. Looking back, there was never a lack of moments of inspiration on this campus that I would bring with me. It was from Andy and Chris's email when they ran for ninth grade class representatives that I learned that some creative emails could end with a poem starting with, "Roses are red." Coach Tozy is the best soccer coach whom I will ever meet. He instilled in us his natural confidence, ability to focus on priorities, and mentally reach beyond our dreams. He even made me believe that I am the best Chinese soccer player, which is true. At an LGBTQ rights protest, I saw through Elijah's determination, both the brutal and the bright side of democracy that I've only heard in Ms. Wainwright's classes. Jackson Neighbors and Nate Tozy's work rate and games of all difficulties taught me the definition of leading by example. Going to a diversity leadership conference alerted me that social justice is more than identifying people's pain. Is also experiencing their beauty. Frankie enlightened me about what supreme leader should be, and the night we all sat by the fire planning for our morning surprise was an example of unity. For someone who doesn't drive, it was also the night I discovered that a golf cart can be more exhilarating than a Porsche. As an international student, I feel blessed to be able to live like an explorer, choosing paths that seemed outrageous at the time, but now have turned into my mode of operating life. I feel supported no matter what I decide to try in my 4 years here, and I'm especially moved by the immense love and nurture I received. It wouldn't be the same without the Bradleys, the Yoons, the Honeycutts, and other local families for offering me to spend time with them during breaks, especially the Katzes for taking me in to live with them for 5 months during the pandemic. It wouldn't be the same without Miss Pollard sending me a hand-picked and decorated sunflower after my first show at Springs. It wouldn't be the same without Ms. Tetzloff and Ms. Brunzel helping me to do Paula Deen makeup for Mr. Woodrow's camp project at 11 o'clock in the morning. It wouldn't be the same without knowing Ms. Deborah, who has been generous to me since the day before my first year. whether it be food or not. It wouldn't be the same in the morning without the morning greetings from Miss Perry in the dorm hallway. It wouldn't be the same without the chit-chats with Mr. Schamburger that would sometimes turn into free food if I'm lucky. It wouldn't be without Miss Barrett's selfless attempt to create new dorm judiciary so that boarders can feel more at home. It wouldn't be the same without Dr. Wright, who taught me how to sing, and Mr. Peterson, who pretty much changed my personality. It wouldn't be the same without a therapy session from Mr. Woodruff after my first heartbreak. And it certainly wouldn't have been the same without everyone else who I haven't mentioned, but who have made my time here unforgettable, sorry y'all. Joseph mentioned that life at Springs has been a bubble that provides us with unconditional love and support. It is so comfortable that our future is scary. While we permit ourselves to feel the sorrow as we embark in our next chapters, let us remember the beautiful memories we've created together and be grateful that they have happened the way they are supposed to. As we leave here, let's continue to embody the spring spirit, be inclusive, supportive, and embrace our fear with courage of the unknown. I don't need to think twice about calling Indian Springs my home and calling you all my family. Thank you to the administration, parents, faculty, staff, and the class of 22, for you have all helped raise me to be who I will become. I love you all.
As the choir makes their way down to the senior section, I will leave you with one last thought, graduates. Similar to the feelings your parents have, the Springs faculty and staff are overwhelmed by great joy and a sense of loss as you prepare to head out into the world. We are excited to see all that you accomplish in life, and we will celebrate every major milestone from afar. We will, however, miss you dearly. No matter where life's twists and turns take you, remember you always have a home at Springs. Congratulations to the Indian Springs class of 2022. I would now ask everyone to please rise for the singing of the alma mater. Thank you.
person you can.